So we've talked about the difference between strong acids and weak acids, and we've talked about how even weak acids can be various strengths. You can have stronger weak acids than others. What we're going to look at in this lesson is how to look at the structure of an acid and be able to make judgments based upon the way they're connected as to which one is stronger and which one is weaker. So we're going to examine two different types of acids. We're going to first examine binary acids, and then we're going to examine oxyacids, because what we look at to judge the strength of the acids is different depending on whether they're binary or oxyacids. So we're going to start with the binary acids. When you're looking at binary acids, we're talking about one element connected to hydrogen. Now, it doesn't have to be a diatomic molecule. So we have all diatomic molecules here with HCl and so forth. It could be something like H2S, okay? It's a binary acid. It has hydrogen and one other element. So that's how we define a binary acid. But when we look at binary acids, we're going to be examining the bond strength. The strength of the bond between the H and the Cl define whether the acid is strong. So in H2S, it's the bond here between the H and the S, the bond strength. Now, if we look at these acids and we're comparing HF, HCl, HBr, HI, just by memorizing who's strong, we can know that HF is weaker than the other guys because HCl, HBr, HI were all on our strong acid list. HF is not. It is weak. Now, we don't know which one's stronger. We just know they're all strong in water. That means they 100% ionize. But if we compare them in other solvents, we can distinguish the strength of the HCl, HBr, and HI. Now, we look at the second column there, and that is bond energy. The energy required to break that bond. You can imagine that if this is going to be a proton donor, the stronger that bond is, the harder it is to donate. So we see up here that HF has got the strongest bond length. Now, you don't want to have to go look up bond energies to determine the strength. So there is a trend. And if the trend is, as you go down the group, okay, the strength of that bond increases. It gets stronger and stronger. So the HF has got the strong, I'm sorry, I said that wrong. As you go down, the acid gets stronger, but the bond strength gets weaker. And that's going to be true down any group of the periodic table. So HF is the strongest bond. Therefore, it is the weakest acid. So just putting these two here, okay, F is further up on the periodic table. You might want to pause and make sure you have a periodic table handy to look at for this and the rest of our lesson. But F is further up. It is going to have a stronger bond because bond strength is going to decrease as you go down. Acid strength is going to increase. So we're not looking at electronegativity when we're comparing these binary acids. So if we compare H2S and H2O as acids, and we don't a lot of times think of water as an acid, but we know it can be thought of as an acid, and we're considering the bond, sorry, put an O there, the bond strength here, I want you to look at a periodic table and predict which one would be stronger. Well, hopefully you said that this would be stronger. It is further down. Sorry. It is further down, therefore it has a weaker bond, therefore a stronger acid. This is further up. It has a stronger bond, therefore it is a weaker acid. Okay, now let's look at the argument for oxyacids. Now, what is an oxyacid? What do we have on the screen there are four examples of oxyacids. All it means is we've got a central atom, we have oxygens surrounding that central atom, and we have a hydrogen attached. Now, that hydrogen that's donatable, which is an acidic proton, is always H is attached to oxygens. So when I see something written like H2SO3, you might be thinking that those hydrogens are attached to the sulfur, but they aren't. They are attached to the oxygens as we see in this image here. And so Almost always when you see an oxy acid, all the hydrogens are attached to oxygens around the central atom. I say almost always. There are a few odd exceptions. H3PO3, for example, has got one of those hydrogens attached to a phosphorus instead of the oxygens. But in general, and just assume that it will be, your hydrogens are attached to oxygens, and then the oxygens are attached to a central atom. So when you have an oxy acid, we're not going to be looking at bond strength, we're going to be looking at a couple of other things, okay? What we're going to be looking at, and I better erase what we have written all over that, what we are really looking at is the polarity of the OH bond, okay? So let's just think about this polarity of the OH bond, and we'll look at nitrous acid here. This bond has to be broken. Now, what does polarity mean? Remember, these two electrons here are being shared by the hydrogen and the oxygen. The more unequal that sharing, okay, the more polar the bond. Well, what is going to drive the unequal sharing is a couple of different factors, okay? We have to divide them into two separate groups. And the first group we're going to look at are oxy acids in which you have everything the same except the central atom is different, okay? So they might have the same number of oxygens, same number of hydrogens, but the central atom is a different atom. So if we were to compare, let me put an N, oh, we had this as one of our examples, right? We had this, if we were to replace the N with a P, okay? If we were to do something like that, then we would have that scenario, a different central atom. Okay, this is a terrible example because it doesn't look like nitrogen is my central atom. The thing that's not oxygen, okay? If we have a different central atom, but they're in the same group, different, but the same number of oxygens, that's what we're looking at here, okay? Now, what is the relationship that we can know based upon their structure? It's this. Acid strength increases with the increasing electronegativity of the central atom. Okay, so I have the central atom, or two different ones. You look at your periodic table, and you determine which one has got the greatest electronegativity between nitrogen and phosphorus. Well, nitrogen is more electronegative, and it says that the acid strength would increase with that. So what's happening here? We're talking about increasing the polarity of this bond. If this is more electronegative, it's going to attract these bond electrons towards it. If it's attracting it towards it, then the oxygen is kind of left a little bit naked in a sense, and so it starts stealing from the hydrogen, and that is going to set up a polarity of the bond. So as you increase the electronegativity of the central atom, in this case nitrogen versus P, you are pulling electron density towards the nitrogen, away from the hydrogen, and that is going to make that bond more polar and allow for that hydrogen to pop off. So if we are going to compare these two guys, they fit this description. They have different central atoms that are in the same group, okay? Same number of oxygens. So which of those two acids is going to be stronger? Well, if you think back to your list of acid strengths, we know that there's six strong acids we had to memorize, and this is one of them. It is the stronger of the two. But I didn't want you to do it based upon memorizing that fact. I wanted you to do it based upon the fact that chlorine is more electronegative than bromine. Okay, so that's the first thing. The second one is if you have the same central atom, but you have different numbers of oxygens attached, okay? It says attached groups, but since these are all oxy acids, these attached groups are going to be oxygen atoms. So you could put the number of attached groups and you could change that to the number of oxygens. Okay? And here is the statement that you need to know. Acid strength increases as the oxidation number of the central atom increases. In other words, and it's easier for me to remember it this way, as the number of oxygen atoms increases. So let's ignore this guy for a moment and let's go back to this one and have another oxyacid. And I'm not doing the full Lewis structure, I'm just kind of showing connectivity here. This has two oxygens attached, this has three oxygens attached. Now the more electronegative atoms, oxygen is very electronegative. They are pulling electron density away from the hydrogen again, and they are causing this bond to become polar as you increase the number of oxygens. So a lot of electronegative oxygens are going to increase the polarity of this bond and cause it to become more acidic. Now this again, on my strong acid list, this was not on my strong acid list. This is why it's a strong acid. It's got so many oxygens, it's really making that bond so polar, it's very easy to pop a hydrogen off. Okay? So those are the two that we just considered, which is the strongest acid. We established it's this. Again, we know this is a strong acid in our strong acid list. Why is it a strong acid? Because it has so many of these oxygens pulling electron density away from the hydrogen and making that bond more polar. Let's compare these. So let's look at the screen kind of closely here. And as we look at these, I said that you increase the number of oxygens, you're going to increase the acid strength. But let's first just consider the oxidation numbers of these guys as a review of oxidation numbers. Okay? The hydrogen is got a plus one oxidation number. That is what we learned when we think about rules of oxidation numbers, that hydrogen is whenever it's connected to a nonmetal. Oxygen, unless it's a peroxide or some unusual situation, is a minus two. So that tells me in this case that chlorine is plus one because all those oxidation numbers must add up to zero. So if this is plus one, this is minus two, and this is minus two, then what does the chlorine have to be in this case? Well, it has to be a plus three, right? And this is a plus one, minus two, minus two, minus two. So what is the chlorine in this case? Whoops, I don't know what that was. Plus five, okay? So all of those add up to overall zero. This is plus one, minus two, minus two, minus two, minus two. And we have a plus seven in this case. Now, if we look back at this statement, which says that acid strength increases with the oxidation number of the central atom, we can see that this one has got the greatest oxidation number. But we don't have to go and do all of that work because what we can see there is always as you increase the number of oxygens, you're going to have to be increasing the oxidation number, okay? So we determine the oxidation number of each chlorine. Okay, what we want to know is which acid is the strongest, and we can either say it is the perchloric acid because it has the highest oxidation number, or we can say it's perchloric acid because it has the most oxygens, or we could say it's perchloric because I memorized that perchloric acid was a strong acid and none of the other ones were on the strong acid list. That would answer the question, wouldn't it? But what if we weren't putting perchloric acid on the list and we were only comparing these three and we said which one's the strongest, okay? Then we would say it's chloric acid. Or if we asked which one is the weakest, it would be the one with the fewest oxygens or the lowest oxidation number. All right, so what we're going to do next is we're going to leave the world of simply being an acid or simply being a base, and we're going to start looking at salts. What are salts? Salts are a type of ionic compound. Salts are an ionic compound that are formed by a neutralization reaction. But what we're going to do is we're going to look at those salts, and we're going to be able to determine, are those salts acids or bases?